Itu entah tu.
Good evening. The American musician Frank Zappa is one of the most exotic, original, and complex figures to have emerged from rock culture. Band leader, guitar hero, composer, satirist, and political commentator, Zappa has eluded easy categorization for three decades. And uniquely among rock idols, the career of the man who put the sneer into rock evolved outside the mainstream of pop history. Something of a recluse in recent years and struggling against serious illness, Zappa agreed to give The Late Show an exclusive glimpse into his world. We went in search of the man, the myth, and the moustache that is Frank Zappa.
Some scientists say that the major building block of the universe is hydrogen because it's the most plentiful element, but my theory is that the universe is made out of stupidity because it is more plentiful than hydrogen. And since it's more plentiful, then why shouldn't we talk about it? I was happy to outrage anybody who liked to be outraged. Take the Kama Sutra. How many people died from the Kama Sutra as opposed to the Bible? Who wins?
American culture has a lot of great mustaches in its history. Mark Twain had a great mustache, Charlie Chaplin, Ben Turpin, but Zappa, he's got the best mustache in American history. He's got that mustache, right? And he's got that little thing on his chin. I think it's called an imperial. That is like the coolest thing. That's like one of the great icons of the 20th century.
Frank Zappa has spent 30 years refining the eclectic style of his music. Since he abandoned live rock in the late 80s and was diagnosed with cancer in 1991, Zappa has worked almost exclusively from his Hollywood Hills home. Compulsive archivist, Zappa recorded nearly all his live performances of the last 15 years and has retrieved from record companies the master tapes of all his studio albums.
What did Frank say it was?
This is just one of four underground vaults in his house, home to hundreds of hours of Zappa music, waiting to be digitally remastered and re-released on CD, the old Masters series, with help from his in-house technical assistants.
Just because you're not working with musicians doesn't mean you're not working. There's certainly a lot of things that have to be done in a very methodical way with the devices that I use. And it's not that I don't interact with people, because I do have a staff here that helps me do all this stuff. I like doing it, and it seems to me that it's liberating not to have the payroll of a rock and roll band and to be the person that has to deal with the types of problems that a band leader is confronted with. It's be a different thing to be an orchestra conductor than to be a rock and roll band leader. It's two different kinds of worlds there. I'm much happier working with my highly skilled technical team here at the Utility Muffin Research Kitchen. I really enjoy working with them.
Now completely outside the mainstream music scene, with his own state-of-the-art studio, record company, and distribution network, Zappa has achieved a unique degree of control over his work. This struggle to achieve independence as a musician has been marked by extremes of indulgence, but also of inspiration, even genius. Resident in his Laurel Canyon retreat, the young Zappa spent his high school years in a very different California, here in the remote town of Lancaster, near Edwards Air Force Base in the Mojave Desert. Zappa's father was a research chemist for the military, and the family moved from the east to the west coast when Frank was 10.
I know I was weird. You know this kind of standard uniform that the rap musicians wear, the hooded parka with the hood up and sunglasses on? That's what I used to wear to school every day. I had a little goatee and a little mustache. And I used to take my guitar with me to school. It was not electric. And spent my time between classes. Plunking around on that.
When I knew Frank in school, he was 2 years ahead of me in high school, and Lancaster was just a barren town. It seems like all the misfits from Los Angeles and San Bernardino counties were sent up there to get out of everybody else's face. There wasn't really anything to do there. You spent most of your time just wandering around through the desert, you know, trying to occupy yourself with anything. You know, that's probably why most people got into music or just out drinking all the time on weekends. That's about all there was to do. But it's one boring town. Believe me.
I hadn't been raised in an environment where there was a lot of music in the house. This couple that owned the chili place, Opal and Chester, agreed to ask the man who serviced the jukebox to put in some of the song titles that I liked, because I promised that I would dutifully keep pumping quarters into this thing so I could listen to them. And so I had the ability to eat good chili and listen to 3 Hours Past Midnight by Johnny Guitar Watson for most of my junior and senior year.
Here it is, 3 hours past midnight.
I'd come into contact with Charlie Parker records and things like that, but they didn't hold my interest. I couldn't follow it. Same kind of argument that you would get from people today. They, you know, what are they doing? They're just noodling around, you know. I mean, now I understand why they're noodling and where they're noodling, and I can tell the difference between good noodling and bad noodling, but without certain musical clues, it just all sounded like noodles to me.
As well as black R&B, young Zappa liked Stravinsky and the dissonant sound experiments of the 1920s French composer Edgar Varèse.
I don't know how I finally got introduced to it. I guess it was because of that Varèse album that I read about in a magazine. Went out and bought it. And imagine what a shock that was after listening to Rhythm and Blues records, then coming home with that album and and hearing ionizations and octandra, things like that. I liked it a lot. Nobody had to explain it to me. It wasn't like jazz. They were doing some noodling in there, but it sounded like they knew what they were doing. It just sounded good to me. It's the dissonance, the way I perceived the dissonance was, these chords are really mean. I like these chords. And the drums are playing loud in this music, and you can hear the drums often in this music, which is something that you could not experience in other types of classical music.
For all his fascination with wildly opposed musical styles, Zappa's rite of passage as a musician took a conventional course, playing in local bands and suffering the indignities of the cocktail lounge combo.
That were playing in Hollywood were trying to get record contracts, so it wasn't that unusual to hear some original songs. But out in this Pomona area, it was unthinkable. You just had to play other people's music, or the customers wouldn't dance. And if they wouldn't dance, they wouldn't drink. And if they wouldn't drink, then the man who owned the bar would be an unhappy person, and you didn't want to, you know, you didn't want to do that to him.
In 1964, Zappa went to Los Angeles and met a group of musicians who were willing to try something new.
I convinced the guys to learn some original songs, and every place we worked, we got fired. The Mothers is a bad name for a group, in that no radio station would ever play our records because the name was too risque. Because at the time, it was, you know, if you were a good musician, you were a motherfucker. And Mothers was short for collection of motherfuckers. And actually, it was kind of presumptuous to name the band that, because we weren't that good musicians. But by bar band standards in the area, we were light years ahead of our competition. But in terms of real musicianship, I suppose we were right down there in a swamp. So out of necessity, we became the Mothers of Invention. It was just by adding those other two words to it, we were able to keep the record company happy. But naturally, the radio stations didn't play the music anyway, because it wasn't about the name of the band. It was what we were singing about and the way the music sounded.
Mr. America, walk on by your schools that do not teach. Mr. America, walk on by the minds that won't.
The Mothers' debut album, Freak Out, was a new kind of collage of pop, blues, and psychedelia with intelligent lyrics, music that used parody and black humor to engage in sharp social satire. The Mothers seemed to be at home with a commercial pop sound and at the same time utterly contemptuous of pop.
Hungry freaks, daddy. They won't go for no more.
The album's acerbic style took even the Mothers' record company by surprise.
They didn't find out until the day that we went in to start recording. In fact, they didn't find out until the second song. I think the first track we laid down was Any Way the Wind Blows, and the second track was Who Are the Brain Police, and I could see Wilson on the phone through the control room window calling the head office in New York saying, well, you're not going to believe this.
The amazing thing about Freak Out was that there was nothing quite like it in rock and roll at the time. It was really simultaneously crude and ugly and incredibly sophisticated. And there was, I mean, the Beatles were funny, but there was nothing with the kind of sneer that you could feel in the music of Frank Zappa.
Do you think that my pants are too tight? Do you think that I'm creepy? Before you say you don't care, shut your fucking mouth about the length of my hair. How would you survive if you were alive, shitty little person?
Although the Mothers' sound could only have come from LA, it wasn't until they left there in 1967 to take up a six-month residency at the Garrick Theatre in New York that they began to find their audience.
We were never that popular in Los Angeles because even compared to New York, Los Angeles is a very conforming community. It just seemed to me that at that time, San Francisco was more conformist, Los Angeles a little bit less. When we moved to New York, there was virtually no scene at all. There was no long-haired anything there. People looked at us like we were from Venus. And by the time a scene did finally erupt in New York City, it was much more interesting because it had ethnic diversity. It had cultural diversity because of all the different parts of the city where there were concrete artistic things going on. There were things happening that were experimental, not necessarily wonderful, but at least experimental, people trying to do something that was different.
This is a song about vegetables. They keep you regular. They're real good for you.
All the vegetable will respond to you.
Some people don't go for prunes. I don't know. I've always found that if they...
We could do anything we wanted out there. It didn't make any difference. That's what the audience was buying a ticket to experience. Two main demands of the audience. They wanted to hear some material that they could recognize, and they wanted to have some sort of live performance experience that nobody else would give them. A surprise, in other words. Whether it's going to be musical or theatrical or something, they would like to have a surprise. And I would like to give them a surprise.
Rutabaga, 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 rutabaga.
After a while, we started inviting people up out of the audience. We had a few problems at first because we would throw things out in the audience and they wind up throwing it back, you know. Bunk got hit one time with a big block of ice somebody threw back up because it was real hot, and we passed out ice through the audience and somebody started throwing it on stage, and it was an interesting time. But the audience was really into it. They loved it. They would line up around the block to come in night after night just to see what kind of bizarre crap we'd come up with.
Fuzzy dice, bongos in my hands, my ship on the ready to attack.
It's not like you would go on stage and there would be a sea of people with long hair all decked out like in 60s fashion, like you know, the special Time Warner version of the 60s. They weren't like that. There were people who were from the suburbs who were coming to this concert out of curiosity, weren't really part of any kind of a scene except their local community, and basically stood there with their mouths open, just going, duh. So some of them decided that they would become hippies, or some would become Greeks, some would become mass murderers, whatever it was. But when they were there, basically it was duh.
Well, I was probably one of those rather stiff people from the suburbs. I think some of us did understand, and we kept coming back for more and more and more. And I remember being very upset when they finally finished their stint at the Garrick Theatre and went back to L.A. I felt as if the real, you know, heart had gone out of New York City, and I had to get back on with my conservatory music training life, which seemed very dull after this. One never knew what to expect. There were some nights that you just heard pure music, and other nights Motorhead would be talking about fixing his car, with Jim Black's drum beat in the background. Sometimes Frank would just sit in a chair and glower at the audience. Sometimes there were more people on stage than there were in the audience. And because of that, Frank even got to know some of us by name. There were so few hardcore mother's freaks then that we were all very noticeable to him. I remember Stravinsky being played. I remember droning music going on for ages, and then in the middle of all of that, the song that then became Oh No, I Don't Believe It, sort of breaking through the clouds. And I mean, it just shocked me how anything could be so beautiful and how such beautiful music could come out of such bizarre looking people.
You say love is all we need. You say with your love you can change all of the fools, all of the hate. I think you're probably out to love.
But having established the Mothers as one of the most formidable and original bands of the 60s, now with a huge following in Europe as well as the United States, Zappa played a characteristic hand. After 5 years and seven albums, he suddenly disbanded the group.
It was getting to the point that I think Frank wasn't going the direction he wanted to and wasn't being as creative as he wanted to. So that's basically how we disbanded. He just got tired and said, hey guys, let's go out into other groups, let's infiltrate other bands, and let's get some fresh ideas. You know, you guys come back, maybe we'll get together 3 or 4 years down the line, bring in your ideas from the groups you have, and let's get back together and do something with it. But it just never happened. The original band was a lot of fun, but we weren't super talented musicians. I mean, we couldn't read classical things. Everybody was good in their own field, but we weren't up to what Frank really wanted, I don't think.
Zappa surprised his large following with the relatively smooth style of Hot Rats, the first album released under his own name. It was mostly instrumental, featuring extended sax, violin and guitar solos, which were melodically accessible as well as musically sophisticated.
It was a major flop in the United States, but for some reason became a top 10 record in England and Holland, and is regarded nostalgically in those places. But the revolutionary thing about that album was the quantity and texture of the overdubbing that was being done on it. 16-track recording was a brand new medium. The 16-track machine that we recorded that album on was practically a prototype. It was as large as that fireplace. This monstro machine.
Standing on the porch of the Lido Hotel. Bruises in the lobby, love the way I smell. My feet, my back, my ass, my hips.
Hot Rats was completely free of the Dada disruptiveness that had characterized the Mothers albums. The one vocal track, Willie the Pimp, was sung by an old high school chum, Captain Beefheart. Then, just when a solo career looked likely, Zappa reformed the Mothers, but with a different lineup, including two singers brought in from the 60s teen group The Turtles. For the new group, he invented a new theatrical style. The old surrealism was played down in favor of increasingly bawdy slapstick humor.
Hi, friends! Did you ever consider the possibility that your penis, or in the case of many dignified ladies, that the size of the titties themselves might provide elements of subconscious tension? Yes, weird, twisted anxieties that could force a person to have to become a politician. Hurrah! A policeman! A Jesuit monk.
Dominus vobiscum et cum
spiritus. A rock and roll guitar player.
"200 Motels," a scatological on-the-road documentary film and record, was Zappa's Heaven's Gate. It cost a lot of money and it met with a mixed critical reception. But the film was important because it showed Zappa's first collaboration with a classical orchestra.
Be moving to
Through the 70s, Zappa the composer and Zappa the rock performer developed an easy coexistence. When he played live, it was with a band who could perform both complicated instrumentals and salacious songs with driving rhythms.
In a little white box that I could sell up town. But by myself, I wouldn't have no boss, 'cause I'd be raising my lonely dental floss.
Let me tell you, Frank was leading the band from every possible aspect and angle and vantage point. Well, he had a series of hand signals. And then, you know, body language is pretty important, too. We all had our eyes on Frank all the time. And you had to, because you never knew what was going to happen. I mean, in the middle of doing something that was very much expected and rehearsed, he could just turn around and do something. He could gesture a certain way or make a face or interject something to the microphone, just say something, or start some banter with, you know, whichever lead singer happened to be there, and the whole concert would take a completely different turn. It was free in that way. It was incredibly tight, but it was free as well. It's an interesting balance.
Help me out, Ruth. Tweezer Glenn, and then I get a cup of coffee and give my foot a push. Just me and the pygmy pony over by the dental floss bush. And then I might just jump back on and ride like a cowboy into the dawn to Montana.
The bottom line with Frank was that he wanted to and needed to get the best that he could from everyone. That was of paramount importance to him, and I think that's why he got such really extraordinary results. He saw what each of us could do, and he wouldn't settle for anything less than that.
For me, it was always more interesting to encounter a musician who had a unique ability, find a way to showcase that and build that unusual skill into the composition. So that forever and ever afterward, that composition would be stamped with the personality of the person who was there when the composition was created.
Has a really incredible insight, sort of an intuition about musicians. I mean, I sat in a room and watched him go through, you know, hordes of musicians, bass players, and we were doing auditions. And he just seems to know, he seems to be able to, you know, get what you're about musically and take that and take it to the top of your ability. Like I say, Frank was the band leader, and I was a musician. I was very fortunate because I loved his music. I remember he said on the phone to me, after he first heard me play, he goes, "I think you're great. I'd like to, you know, try you out for the band." He goes, "But how do I know that you won't be a miserable son of a bitch having to play my music?" You know, I was the tool of the composer.
Make a fuss, just get on the bus.
Although it couldn't strictly be called commercialism, Zappa knew his audience, and he deliberately stoked up the sexual satire and the mythologizing of low-life rock tour culture with seemingly endless songs about groupies, motels and tour buses and impossibly perverted musicians. Zappa on sex is what usually draws the critics' fire.
Well, let's look at the statistics. I think that the last time anybody checked, my catalog is about 1,200 titles. And I would be amazed if more than 100 of them were on sexual topics.
I'm a simple person, you know? I have very small desires in life. Titties and beer.
I'm making comments about society, and the society that I was commenting on was engaged in what they love to describe as the sexual revolution. A world of sexual incompetence encountering each other under disco circumstances. Now, can't you do songs about that?
A good loving man, it's hardest to find. A good woman needs to ease her mind. I know a few that need to ease it behind. All you gotta do is grease it down and everything is fine. Keep it greasy so it'll go down easy.
One of the great things about Frank's satire is that he picks targets that can't stand to be laughed at. And that's a real, real great secret of humor. You gotta pick the people who get the most upset and crazed when you make fun of them, and Zappa did it time and time again. He picks targets I would never pick, but he does some good ones, and that's definitely been an inspiration to me.
Women's liberation came creeping all across the nation. I tell you people, I was not ready when I fucked this dyke by the name of Freddy. She made a little speech then. Ah, she tried to make me say when. She had my balls in a vice, but she left the dick. I guess I still hooked on, but now it shoots too quick.
Well, have you ever looked at people fucking? Ouch. I mean, that's a silly looking thing to begin with. It's silly looking. Let's face it. It looks silly. Why not say so? And from that, you could develop a number of theories about it, whether or not it should be celebrated. I mean, so what if it feels good? It's still silly. I mean, now's the time to whip out this magazine. Hey, please, look, here it is, the 90s. Here's where we are. We're to this now. Shouldn't somebody say something about people who will buy $1,000 dildo things that they plug into their computer to do stuff to them with 3D goggles attached to it? There's got to be an album in there someplace.
Don't fool yourself, girl. It's going right out of your shoe. Don't fool yourself, girl. It's going right out of your shoe. Don't fool yourself, girl. It's going right out of your shoe.
I knew you'd be surprised.
It's pretty easy to hate me for whatever you choose to hate me for, because I'm virtually unrepentant, and I just don't care. My insensitivity is pretty evenly spread around.
A foolish man, but the Negro persuasion.
In 1978, after winning a lawsuit against Warner Brothers, Zappa was free to put out records on his own label. He then went into overdrive. In the 80s, he was releasing albums every few months, including one of live guitar solos, 80 minutes worth. Zappa now entered rock's pantheon of guitar heroes.
Thank you. Frank had great feedback from Cole when he played. And it was great to sit and just watch him play, just on stage. And sometimes I didn't even have anything to play. I just stood and watched him. When he's playing his guitar, when I was on stage watching him, he always seemed like he had a concentration that was, you know, because the solos would go on for 9 minutes, 10 minutes sometimes, even longer, you know. But there was a continuity to it that I think a lot of people, after a point, just becomes like, you know, flailing. But he definitely held a continuity, and that's a great strength of concentration. In my opinion, it's in a sense it's old school in the way that it's bluesy. I mean, he has very many different sides. I mean, he can like just play over a real heavy rock vamp, really heavy, and he's got these blues runs and stuff that are very, you know, so in a way old style, but they have a lot of chops, like a lot of balls or grit to them, like they have a lot of cayenne pepper or something, you know.
He doesn't look at the instrument in terms of, you know, all the standard ways. Like, for example, you know, you pick up a guitar and there's little boxes that your fingers can go in that you could conceivably play in. Frank doesn't think of those sort of technical things at all. He's all over the place playing notes that he wants to play because he hears everything that's going on in the music around him, and he creates this air sculpture, as he calls it, when he plays.
It's so cool.
It should be illegal to
at rehearsals or something, he'll be playing. And all of a sudden you'll see his face go, you know, and he's like, oh, God, like someone will, like, make a mistake. And he's like, you know, and, like, it hits him. Like, the wrong note hits him. And it's like, ah, oh, do it again. You know, he's playing. And, like, it's so loud. And you're going, how the hell can he hear anything? You know?
I mean.
And the monitors can be really bad.
Yeah,
but
see,
most of the time,
the music that the band is trying to play is so complicated. And to hear the one wrong note out of everything that's going on stage and not, you know, I mean, sometimes you don't have certain instruments up as loud as others, but he always catches that stuff.
He's insane.
It's frightening. He's got the magic ears.
Zappa finally stopped playing live in 1988. Tiring of life on the road and his band squabbling, he turned to business and politics. He set up his own company to trade with Eastern Europe, and a visit to post-revolutionary Prague in 1991 led to an unexpected alliance with the Czech government.
It was during my Prague visit that I was introduced to various people in the government, including Havel. And various finance ministers. As a result of these meetings, I proposed to them that if they needed some sort of representation in the West to help them get investment or whatever they needed to do, that I would be interested in doing that.
Dobrý večer, hello Franky. Pane ministře, máte slovo. Prosit ministra kultury, řekněte mi.
The minister gave me a letter saying that I represented the government for trade, tourism, and culture. just single, simple little letter. And so started making phone calls to try and, you know, organize things for them. But there was a lot of behind the scenes backstabbing and weird stuff going on that I wasn't aware of.
We came here today to watch communism die.
I've never been shy about saying what's on my mind, and at this luncheon engagement with Havel, he was talking about how Dan Quayle was coming to visit them, and I expressed the opinion that I thought that it was unfortunate that a person such as President Havel should have to bear the company of somebody as stupid as Dan Quayle for even a few moments of his life. And the next thing I know, Quayle doesn't come. Instead, what's his name? James Baker III reroutes his trip to Moscow so that he can come blasting into Prague and literally lays down the law to the Czech government. He says, you can either do business with the United States or you can do business with Zappa. What'll it be? Well, that was my brief but unhappy relationship with the Czech government.
Since the announcement of his illness in 1991, Zappa has concentrated on remastering music from his archive, but also writing new compositions outside the rock tradition. His most recent project has been to adapt some of his computer compositions for Germany's Ensemble Moderne. These were performed in Frankfurt and Vienna last September.
Well, you've got to understand that the Yellow Shark isn't really a piece. It was just the name of the evening. It was the name of the event.
Okay, so try and keep the clusters very dense.
It was the kind of music that the machine couldn't do. And it's also the kind of music that I would imagine other groups couldn't play. It was pretty much designed for them.
Now, you have to remember these things because they can happen anytime.
It was only interesting because the musicians themselves were interesting and their approach to music was interesting. It was something that I had always hoped to encounter with some group of musicians somewhere, sometime. But I mean, part of the charm of doing the project was because of the personalities of the people in the group and what their aesthetic was.
Despite his illness, despite no longer performing live, Zappa has lost none of his relish for experimentation. He recently held what he called a salon at his house, where he recorded the combined sound made by the Chieftains from Ireland, a Tuvan throat singing group from Mongolia, and his old friend Johnny Guitar Watson.
Did you improvise the words?
Absolutely.
Just flying right on in there.
Apparently not.
It would be very nice, Frank, if the Bowerons started and they were to start a drone. And Matt came in on the flute. How about that?
Yeah.
so far, well, let's see, within the last couple of months, I've finished off 3 albums. So there's plenty of stuff coming out this year. The thing that we're dumping to tape right now from the hard disk is a project called Civilization Phase 3. And I'm expecting to have a meeting with some people from the Vienna Opera later this month, and I'm going to talk to them about mounting it as a live production. And if they decide to do it, then that will be the next major thing to occupy my time. If not, I'll find something else.
Thank you, everyone, for coming to our
soiree
tonight. And hope to have another one of these days. Good night.
Thank you so much.
All right. Sweet chief.
Since that film was first shown earlier this year, Frank Zappa has given us permission to screen some of the material from his archive, to which we have added a rare Mothers of Invention performance from the BBC library, unseen since 1968. For the next 90 minutes, The Late Show offers a unique glimpse into some of the musical highlights of Frank Vincent Zappa.
I'd like to thank the people at the BBC for giving us a chance to do some of the things on television here that they would never let us do in the United States. Intimate musical entertainment. We heard about how people in this land like traditional jazz. And this is sort of a nifty little number with a lilt, a little lift, a little swing to it. We'll be right back.
Hello, Teenage America.
Motorhead covets the uniforms of the other band. And also shows some interest in the bum of Underwood.
Hey, can I play
in
your band and get a suit like that too?
No!
But I like the suits and I can play good. I can play anything.
He will join their group whether they like it or not.